Oh my gosh, it has been a while since we spoke about the webp vulnerability that I titled A Vulnerability to Hack the World, and I'm really sorry about that. The past few months I decided to prioritize Hackstory and I ended up not making videos for 6 months, but that doesn't mean I didn't make videos. I made at least over 100 shorter videos for our Hackstory courses, mainly the Android application security courses, which are also sponsored by Google. So if you missed me, check them out, I think they are great. But let's come back to one of the promises that I haven't delivered on yet. Remember the webp vulnerability? The exploit involved passkit attachments containing malicious images sent from an attacker iMessage account to the victim. Well, after 2 videos looking into it, I was left with one big question. If fuzzing couldn't find it, and we only found it with persistent fuzzing because we knew where to look, how did they discover this vulnerability in the first place? I actually have a theory and I will tell you all about it next video. Oof, even my glasses changed since then, but now is the time. Let's talk about this and let me tell you my theory how this was discovered. All right. Let's start from the beginning and build up to my discovery theory. To do that, let's put ourselves in the position of a vulnerability researcher, or rather a whole team that wants to remotely hack iPhones. Now, admittedly, I have absolutely zero personal experience in that area, but I've talked to many vulnerability researchers over the years, and so I have some ideas how that could work. And well, our goal is to attack an iPhone remotely, which means in the end, we need to exploit some kind of software on the phone. So we have to think about all the different data inputs that exist between a random person, the attacker, and the victim's phone. And that basically only leaves us with various communication channels. You can call a stranger with their phone number, you can send an email to a stranger if you know their address, and you can write SMS or MMS, or more complex messages through various messengers such as WhatsApp, Signal, or the default iMessage. So as a remote outside attacker, we need to look into these programs handling these kind of inputs. And especially iMessage is of course a good target because it exists on every iPhone. There's also a perfect article by Natalie Silvanovich from Google Project Zero analyzing exactly that, the fully remote attack surface of the iPhone, talking about SMS, email, and so forth. But of course, iMessage is a huge complexity target. Long story short, it makes perfect sense that a team interested in hacking iPhones remotely will research iMessage very deeply. You can see that, for example, in another excellent Google Project Zero article about remote iOS exploitation. In order to deliver an exploit over iMessage, one needs to be able to send custom iMessages to the target. This requires interacting with Apple's servers and dealing with iMessage's end-to-end encryption, and an easy way to do this, which was used for this research, is to use existing code by hooking into the iMessage handling code inside iMAgent with a tool like Frida. This sentence highlights something important. This kind of research takes a huge amount of effort, not only creatively, but also on an engineering level. You need to develop custom tooling just to be able to start looking for vulnerabilities, which increases the economical risk a lot because you don't know whether all this work will pay off with a vulnerability at the end. And that's one reason why these exploits are so expensive. But all right, we're gonna start target iMessage, but what area are we exactly targeting? Well, this requires more tooling and research. Here, for example, in this footage, courtesy of Dr. Yiska, we can see a small script that hooks into the iOS Grand Central Dispatch used extensively within iOS apps. And it gives you visibility, including a backtrace about what kind of functions are getting called. And so, for example, when in iMessage you receive an image file, you can see lots of activity. And we can see references to image.io, which is basically the library in iOS to parse image file formats. Now, whether this particular backtrace is about our image getting parsed or maybe just some other UI elements being handled somewhere, we don't know yet. Point is, you dig deeper and deeper and deeper to understand the target app. As attackers, we should also be happy about complexity because the more code there is, the more bugs there will be. And more complicated code probably also increases the risk of mistakes on the developer side. And sending an image or another file that gets previewed in a chat is exactly that kind of complexity. For most people, sending an image doesn't feel complex, but in reality, image file formats are no joke. there's lots of science like math going into the algorithms for compressions, and these algorithms then have to be implemented efficiently. So file format parsing is always a worthwhile target. And obviously, it's not just one image format. An app like iMessage wants to support lots of formats. And so Apple's Image I/O, for example, supports GIF, PNG, weird stuff I've never heard about, and WebP. But Apple has done something really cool in iOS 14. After accepting this kind of huge risk of this exploit vector, Apple introduced BlastDoor. BlastDoor is a heavily sandboxed security service process that actually performs the parsing. In another article by Google Project Zero, a look at iMessage in iOS 14, they made this graphics to showcase roughly how an incoming iMessage is processed. So your phone message receives a push message, the IM agent, the instant messaging agent, forwards the payload to the BlastDoor process, the BlastDoor service then parses the text in XML and deserializes some stuff. And if the message also contains some images or other data, it will be sent using this IM transcoder agent to BlastDoor as well to perform the deserialization and create the message preview of maybe some of the images. This is complex, but the idea is good. If there is a vulnerability in an image format or some other message deserialization and the BlastDoor service process gets exploited, then there is a heavy sandbox that an attacker hopefully cannot escape from. If you take an iOS system IPSW image, mount the system partition and look for files named BlastDoor, you can also find this sandbox policy file. Here you can see, for example, restrictive rules to only allow file reading of specific paths, and that's just one way how the sandbox works. So this is the sandbox policy for the message BlastDoor service, and we can actually also find this. This is the binary of that service, and with otool-l, we can look at the dynamically linked libraries used by the service. And there you can also find image.io. So I guess the image parsing of WebP files within BlastDoor is also done with image.io. Long story short, image file formats are a good target. You can now look at what image.io is using to parse the different file formats and start looking for vulnerabilities there. Which of course is also not a new idea. There's another Google Project Zero article about that, fuzzing image.io by Saelo. This blog post discusses an old type of issue, vulnerabilities in image format parsers. But in a newer context, popular messenger apps. This research was focused on the image parsing API provided by image.io. Multiple vulnerabilities in image parsing code were found, reported to Apple or the respective open source image library maintainers, and subsequently fixed. You can see, this is a very common area for security research, and image formats are also a great playground for fuzzers. And yet, the WebP vulnerability was not found before. But to be fair, WebP is in fact a rather new addition to image.io as well. It came with iOS 14 in 2020. But it's also not coming out of nowhere. Image.io is also just using the actual library libwebp. So there is a chance that vulnerability researchers knew this vulnerability long before iOS started to integrate the webp library. Maybe they even used it already in the wild against other targets and just adapted it for iOS when it was added. But there has been absolutely no reports about this. It's just a possibility. All right. We want to hack iPhones remotely. We think targeting iMessage is giving us a large attack surface, and we know that image formats are a typical source of issues. And this, again, is nothing new. This is almost like how the standard iOS exploit always looks like. And you can see that when looking at other known exploits. For example, the incredible forced entry exploit, that one was also based on an image format, JBIG2. So I think it makes sense that there are people, maybe even teams, that are very knowledgeable about the inner workings of various image parsers. And I think that is not just a theory. The forced entry exploit using JBIG2 images was attributed to NSO. NSO was also attributed to Pwn Your Home. The phone downloaded PNG images from iMessage. Processing these images caused crashes in Message's BlastDoor service process. And NSO is also attributed to BlastPASS, the WebP vulnerability. I don't know how certain those attributions are. They could be wrong, could be a different company or them just buying the exploits. But either way, you can see that image parsing is a pattern in these advanced exploits. And so there must be experts on this, people who have spent thousands of hours with their heads in image parsing code. And now we slowly get to my ultimate theory. So when I looked again at the forced entry write-up from Google Project Zero, I noticed something very familiar. Decoding a Huffman table. And the vulnerability appears to be related to counting number of symbols, which reminded me a lot of the Huffman table symbol stuff we have seen in the WebP vulnerability. And that made it click for me. Huffman tables are a common occurrence in image file formats. The Huffman table algorithm implemented in WebP had the vulnerability. And don't people just copy these kind of generic algorithms from another? This must exist in similar form in other image formats as well. So I started looking. And here, for example, on the left, I found a JPEG XL library, JXL, implementing the Huffman table decoding, which looks basically the same like the libwebp implementation. There's a count array, it's looping over it, decrementing the count, and then it's moving a table pointer forward. I mean, it's a Huffman table implementation, of course they look the same. And so is that one vulnerable as well? Well, I tried to fuzz it and it didn't crash. There's some table resizing going on as well, so maybe it's safe, but to be honest, I lack the skills. Maybe there's a 0 day here or not. Maybe somebody else has to check. But still, this is intriguing. And so I thought there must be more. Ultimately, the mistake that WebP made was trusting the output from the tool enough.c to calculate the maximum possible table size. From the WebP source code above the hard-coded table sizes, the comment says, all values computed for 8-bit first level lookups with Mark Adler's tool enough.c. And so I was wondering, are there other image formats or compression tools that trust this output? So I went to the GitHub search and started to look for C code where the tool shows up in the comments. And look here. Here, for example, is the zlib implementation talking about the table size calculations. But it also makes sense because that is where the enough.c tool is from. But I kept looking around and I found Brunsley, a practical JPEG repacker by Google. And in the JPEG Huffman decode header file, I found the following. Maximum Huffman lookup table size, hard-coded to 1024. Referencing enough.c, but enough.c works with an assumption that Huffman code is complete. Input JPEG files might have this assumption broken. It is assumed that the subtable of each size might be almost completely filled with repetitions. Listen to me, input JPEGs might have this assumption broken. To me, it sounds like the author of this comment knew that enough.c calculates only table sizes for correct tables, but input JPEGs, so maliciously supplied JPEG files, might be malformed. And if you look at the git blame of this file, we can see that this change was 3 years ago. And if you go back to before that, this Huffman LUT size was smaller, and that did not contain this warning. And I think that is so curious. Unfortunately, the commit that apparently patched this was just labeled fix MSVC compilation warnings, and it contains lots of different changes, so it's a kind of weird commit and it's not clearly tied to some kind of security fix. But I could totally imagine that an internal fuzzer or just the developer during testing figured this out, leading to this code change and this comment. And now imagine you are a vulnerability researcher who is looking at all these different file formats for a long time. You have set up fuzzers, you audited code by hand, you wrote your own parsers to understand the file formats. This is just the niche you are working in. You are always looking into implementations of new image parsers, looking for new code, new bugs. And this is just a theory, but I can see how a vulnerability researcher focusing on image formats came across this comment. And in a very similar way, how it clicked for me, it could have clicked for them. Input JPEGs might have this assumption broken. You cannot trust enough.c for this number. And then you remember you have seen this before in this other image format, WebP, that also mentions the table size calculations with enough.c. Well, if you then set up a fuzzer like we have done in the previous episode, specifically only fuzzing the WebP Huffman table implementation, then you would immediately find this crash. And yes, it's just a theory, but to me it's a very satisfying theory. I can now say, yes, I see a realistic path to discovery, without it being crazy black magic. But I'm curious, what do you think? Or do you have another theory? Comment below. Also, if you happen to be the researcher who found this vulnerability in the first place, please leak the discovery method to me. But yeah, until then, thanks for watching. See you soon. And if you want to learn more about hacking, check out our courses over at hackstreet.io. We just recently published an entire Android application security course sponsored by Google. Google wants more bug hunters to look at their Android app bug bounty. Google has hundreds of apps in scope, and so these courses should teach you everything you need to know to get started in finding real bugs. So head over to hackstreet.io and maybe start your Android app hacking career.